Second round game between the University of Texas El Paso Miners and the Hawkeyes from the University of Arizona, or from the University of Iowa. And now let's meet the starting lineups. For Texas El Paso at forward, a 6'7 senior from Los Angeles, California, number 11, Quinton Gates. For Iowa at forward, a 6'5 sophomore from Flint, Michigan, number 23, Roy Marble. Also at forward for Texas El Paso, a 6'6 junior from Long Beach, California, number 32, Chris Sandel. For Iowa at forward, a 7-foot senior from Glendale, Arizona, number 54, Brad Lohas. For Texas El Paso at center, a 6'7 senior from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, number 50, Mike Richmond. For Iowa at center, a 6'7 senior from San Bernardino, California, number 3, Gary Wright. For Texas El Paso at guard, a 5'10 sophomore from Chicago, Illinois, number 10, Tim Hardaway. For Iowa at guard, a 6'2 sophomore from Detroit, Michigan, number 10, B.J. Armstrong. For Texas El Paso at guard, a 6'1 senior from Gardena, California, number 22, Hernell Jackson. For Iowa at guard, a 6'6 senior from Springfield, Illinois, number 35, Kevin Campbell. And now, ladies and gentlemen, introducing the head coaches for Texas El Paso in his 25th season, Don Haskins. For Iowa in his first season, Tom Davis.
Iowa has won 5 in a row and 9 of 11. UTEP, 10 of their last 11. Two red hot teams getting set to square off. We'll be back with the opening tip in a moment. Tucson, Arizona, 7th-seeded University of Texas at El Paso with a 25-6 record. They beat Arizona in overtime. Keep in mind that Arizona plays on this floor, so it was a big victory for UTEP. And UTEP this year, as you look at Iowa, UTEP lost to Georgetown by 4 points on the road earlier this year. And Iowa's 4 losses to Ohio State, Michigan, Purdue, and Indiana. All tournament teams from the Big Ten. What to look for, Tommy?
UTEP must beat the toughest zone threats in the country. They can't afford turnovers. They've got to make Iowa pay for the gamble of the press. They've got to make easy baskets off the fast break. Iowa must be able to score inside if they can't get the fast break against a great denied defense.
UTEP controls, and it's Tim Hardaway, the point guard, who's made great strides as a point guard. Chris Sandel, the first basket of the ball game, the leading scorer for the Miners, averaging 13 a game. Iowa quickly back. And it's Lohas, the 7-footer, missing a 3-point shot, and he can roam out there, and he'll be an active 7-footer today.
UTEP, a very effective fast break ball club.
Richmond, the center, out of bounds. It's Iowa ball, and this game may be quicker paced than we expected, Tom.
Iowa tries to force you to play the pace game, and they throw that pressure defense at you for the entire ball game.
UTEP in their familiar man-to-man defense, one of the best, but they get the pass inside to the baseline, and the basket by Kevin Gamble, who's averaging over 11 points a game, and a discontinued turnover against UTEP gives the ball to Iowa.
Here comes a bounce pass inside to the postman. Tom Davis, a believer that that's the way to feed the post on the floor. It paid off that time.
B.J. Armstrong is the point guard for Iowa. Wright can't hold on. Wasn't a good pass from Armstrong. And UTEP coming on 3-on-1. The shot going up by Quinton Gates misses. And now Gamble has the rebound into the hands of Armstrong, the point guard. And another turnover. Deep Jackson beating Mike Richmond for the pass shot. Lohas, the rebound, and the foul is against Quinton Gates of UTEP. And what a sizzling start to this game.
I believe UTEP has the ability, once they beat the zone press, to take it at fast break speed. You watch them now push it up the court. They are very good at this. You notice their big wingman, pull-up shooter jumper. Most big guys like him would have tried to go in and slam it. So there's a little finesse on their fast break.
The officials are Booker Turner, Tom Frame, and Willis McJunkin. Armstrong being defended by Tim Hardaway, Kevin Gamble, and now they go out to Gary Wright. Still Iowa ball, the Hawkeyes. Pressure defense and pressure offense, and that's the name of Tom Davis's game, and he was successful with it at Boston College. He's got a better group here.
Haskins says that Iowa's defense is their best offense, but they've got some pretty good scorers here, like Lojas, Wright, and this man in particular.
Roy Marble. If Iowa has a star, he's it. Roy Marble, averaging 14.8 and a steal on the pressure in the basket by Marble again. And here is that pressure.
The first job is to inbound the ball. That's difficult enough with Lojas, the seven-footer, standing there trying to make a steal.
6-2 the score. Quinton Gates misses in a long rebound and a three-on-three now. And Hardaway slowed up the break. Gamble misses from the corner. Loose ball into the hands of Chris Sandel. And here comes UTEP. Hardaway pushes it up all the way and gets the basket. It's 6-4.
And it comes right back in your face.
They like to use the seven-footer Lojas out on the perimeter. He's a good passer. Gets the ball into Armstrong, and the point guard makes it 8-4 in favor of Iowa.
They set great picks, Iowa.
Again, it's 3-on-2 fast break. The reverse layup is missed by Jeep Jackson. Sometimes he can be out of control, but he is a wonder to watch. Gamble deflected out of bounds. It's Iowa ball, and here come the substitutions. For Iowa, maybe the best sixth man in the country, Jeff Moe, a man who relishes that role. Also coming into the ball game is Ed Horton, number 25. There's Bill Jones, a forward, number 14.
And Dick, this is like the Chinese army. They throw waves and waves of troops at you. You're not afraid.
Jackson intercepts the inbound pass. And Jeep Jackson with the basket. Also in the ball game is Chris Blocker, and you'll like him, a junior college All-American transfer for UTEP. He's wearing number 23. It's 8-6 in favor of Iowa. Blistering pace to start out here. Lojas, the seven-footer. This is in the rebound by Chris Sandel. Gets it out to Blocker. Blocker, straight feed to Richmond, but he missed the layup. Now Iowa back. Jones goes up without the ball, and now it's 3-on-1. And Hardaway's pass, no basket, as Richmond laid it in and a foul before the shot. And Tom, do you remember any game, college or pro, that started out at this pace?
You would have thought the Oklahoma game against Pitt was going to be fast-paced, but this one looks like it's got to beat at least in the first few minutes.
There's Al Lorenzen, a 6'9 junior from Cedar Rapids, who's a good shooter and a power forward, has been bothered by leg injuries in there now. So wholesale substitutions as expected by Tom Davis. And of course, he uses everyone and keeps everyone involved.
Wave after wave after wave of troops. They try to kill you with numbers.
Jackson and Hardaway, the backcourt. Blocker is in there up front. And Sandel shoots and hits. That's a two-point shot for Sandel to tie the game.
Iowa was in a zone that time.
They go low inside. Marvin. Now Lorenzen. Lorenzen scores. And a foul as well.
Iowa's motion offense, Dick, is outstanding in that they set beautiful picks to free people. Watch them just move the ball around. Inside it goes. And you watch the help weak side of the UTEP defense. Iowa takes advantage of it by getting it to Lorenzen, and he scored.
The foul was on Chris Sandel, and so here is Al Lorenzen. And we already have four substitutions for Iowa. The only man who started the game still in there is Roy Marble for Tom Davis. Lorenzen misses the free throw. Horton tries to save it, and it's in the hands of Marble. Iowa leading 10-8. And a little more than 4 minutes gone by in this game. First half. Tremendous action here in Tucson. Gambling is Hardaway for the steal, and they'll call the foul on Tim Hardaway.
The guards of UTEP will be out challenging in the passing lane. It's very difficult against UTEP's defense in the low post to feed the ball in the low post. They three-quarter. They get in the passing lane with their hands.
You got to be in great shape to play the press, and that's why 10 of Iowa's players are averaging at least 11 minutes of action a game. The only one in the 30s is Roy Marble. Lorenzen outside. Being guarded by Wayne Campbell, who's come in. He started the year, a three-point shot by Jeff Moe, who's the best three-point shooter in the Big Ten, and Iowa leads by five.
On the press that time, handled nicely by UTEP.
UTEP slowing it up, trying to get a good shot. Keith Jackson hits a three-pointer for UTEP. Jackson scored 9 of UTEP's 19 points in overtime in their first-round victory over Arizona. 13-11 now, Hawkeye. Marble has the ball knocked away. Great defense, helping defense by UTEP.
That's what UTEP does so well. Great hands by their two guards.
Locker going in and gets the basket. Chris Blocker, who scored 12 off the bench in UTEP's first-round win.
Excellent ball handler now, the third man to help beat the UTEP press.
5 in a row run off by UTEP. Horton misses the shot. Keith Jackson tries to save it, and it's going to be Iowa ball. And another substitution coming in the ball game for the Miners. As you look at the turnover story, Terry Stallworth, the 6'4 sophomore from Long Beach, received against Iowa's press yesterday, and this is the idea.
Yeah, the first big problem is how to inbound the ball. Then you got to beat a big trap situation. Here's the first problem, inbounding the ball. Lohaus, the 7-footer, and there's a man from Iowa standing right there where he thought his teammate was going to be, and they make easy baskets like that. You can't hardly see your teammates when Lohaus is surrounding the man taking the ball out of bounds.
Not only that, Tom Davis camouflages the different defenses too.
As to where the openings might be, Haskins says this is one defense where they force you to put the ball where they want you to put the ball.
Meanwhile, Iowa inbounding in a 13-13 game. Jeff Moe and B.J. Armstrong are the guards. Grant Lohaus back in there. Gary Wright up front and forward, along with Kevin Gamble. And on the turnover, Keith Jackson lays it in to give UTEP their first lead since 2-0.
They will be out hawking the ball, these little guards of UTEP. Keith Jackson, Hardaway.
They like to keep Lohaus away. Wright, in essence, is their center. Moe goes up and is called for the offensive foul. 7th turnover by Iowa, Tom.
Not using big people in that low post. How does a guard get down in the low post?
And it is still going UTEP's way.
There it is. Again, having difficulty just inbounding the ball.
Now, they did not call that foul. It was just lost, they said, by Moe. So, no foul on Moe. UTEP has scored 7 in a row, trying to get it inbounds. And they do to Quinnen Gates. And Iowa goes back in the zone.
And the 5-second almost went off that time before the ball was inbounded. They put you under such pressure.
Kevin Gamble is the point man in the 1-2-2 zone for Iowa. Same defense that Tom Davis used at Boston College. Blocker with a fake and an off-balance shot. And it almost went. And the rebound by Gary Wright. Armstrong. Two-point shot, two-point basket by B.J. Armstrong, the sophomore from Detroit. Turnover, Moe puts Iowa in front by 2.
Boy, that's a great steal by Gamble, a much bigger player than the Jeep.
Terry Stallworth in the forecourt. Moe all over. What a great spark that Jeff Moe is coming off the bench. And as we said, he likes that role of sixth man. Baseline, Quinnen Gates with a fine move.
Now, there's a man I think is really going to have an effect in this ball game. Very clever offensive player, Quinnen Gates.
Armstrong guarded by Jackson. Moe defensed by Stallworth. Lohaus up on top. They find Armstrong. Shot blocked and the foul is called against Terry Stallworth. And coming back in the ball game is Chris Sandel for UTEP and Tim Hardaway, their point guard.
See what what I meant on that last play, Dick. The ball gets inside, and you get surrounded there with three men surrounding Armstrong when he tried to put that shot up.
Ogo's out of the game, but not before he hit a three-pointer and had 5 points, and his Iowa's leading scorer. And on the line now is Armstrong as Roy Marble, their leading scorer for the Hawkeyes, also returns.
That's unusual. Lojas, the biggest man on the court at over 7 feet, very rarely plays in the low post. They keep him on the outside as a big target for passing, and he can see inside to make good passes to guys like Armstrong.
Iowa by two with 12:32 to go, first half. Basically, UTEP has done a pretty good job of getting that ball inbound and have even attacked the basket and made Iowa pay, which is what Don Haskins wants to do today.
Be ahead if they've made a few layups against that lone defender in the press.
Gates up on top. Hardaway. They get it inside to Wayne Campbell. And there is that man Gates. Tipped up and in, and it's offensive interference called against the Miners. Turns the ball over to Iowa.
And there were two UTEP rebounders rebounding against Lojas, the seven-footer. And boy, they were quicker to the jump than he was. Watch it slide inside. Lojas goes after him. And there's Quinton Gates up back inside. And I don't think the ball was over the cylinder that time.
So Iowa, 14-0 in non-conference games. Moving past right to Marble. They couldn't make it. Marble gets the basket. And UTEP inbound successfully. Gates goes up off the glass, and Armstrong with a 3-on-1, 4-on-1 break for Iowa, broken up by Hardaway. Great defense by Tim Hardaway, both ends of the floor. He gets the basket.
4-on-1 fast break, and you steal it. That's a play.
21-19 Iowa, and another turnover. That time it was Stallworth who caused it. 9 turnovers by Iowa.
UTEP uses their feet on defense in that man-to-man. They move.
Push on. And that's the toughest defense you can play is man-to-man. And now the Miners looking to tie this game. We've already had 5 ties in this first half with 11:05 remaining. Second-seeded Iowa against upset-minded UTEP. But Don Haskins, 26 years, is crafty. If anyone knows how to pull the big upset, he can. Going to call a 3-second violation against UTEP.
There's the quick feed. There you see Hardaway just pick it off and steam up. I mean, he had them all that time. And normal thing is to run, turn your back and hide as they come at you. Instead, he changed it into 2 points.
The Bill Jones, a 6'7 junior, comes in for Iowa. There's Chris Blocker, who's a junior and has long arms. He's out of Philadelphia and is a big factor for this UTEP team coming off the bench. Armstrong, starting point guard, is out of there. Might have been shaken up for the moment. Wright gets it inside to Marble. The basket, no. Traveling called against Roy Marble. And Iowa gets set to press again as UTEP will take it out. On the side.
They tried several alley-oops, Iowa, and UTEP right there.
UTEP is not a tall team, but they have a bunch of leapers. And they have interchangeable parts no matter what position they're listed at when they start.
All of them are good passes. That's why I think they'll be able to handle Iowa's zone press.
UTEP trying to tie this game. Air ball by Jeep Jackson. Rebound by Lojas. Not quite a rebound as he picked it off. Now Bill Jones. Moe for three. He's hit one earlier. And the rebound by Sandel for UTEP. Nearly halfway through this first half. Iowa leading UTEP 21-19. Hawkeyes had a 5-point lead and UTEP came back. Jeep Jackson off balance. Loses it again. He's made 3 plays that were not wise plays in traffic so far.
Well, they missed him for a 2-count. Otherwise, he would have got a layup.
Moe misses a 3. Blocker, 4-on-1. Now 4-on-2. Good feed to Hardaway. Blocker, what a pass.
Say, a blocker, they say, is a flashy player. But I don't think he's that much flash. I think he does it just for with a big purpose in mind.
And our 6th tie of this 21. Iowa 28-4 with five in a row. And Marble breaks the tie. Roy Marble now with 8 points is the game's high score. But here's a three-on-one. Comes back, ties it up for Texas. UTEP, and we'll have a chance to put him ahead.
Once you beat the trap on the zone press, and you can get the ball into the middle, there's only one defender left. And UTEP is a three-on-one situation, a good fast break team. Now, you watch them get the ball up quickly, and immediately it's a fast break situation, and UTEP, a fast break team, says, hey, that's just what we want. Three-on-ones, we'll score.
There's Wayne Campbell, who is the best offensive rebounder on this team. He comes off the bench, started earlier in the year, had knee surgery, and a pretty courageous comeback for Wayne Campbell, the junior out of New Orleans. So UTEP making Iowa pay. Jackson misses a chance for a three-point play, and there's Wayne Campbell, that offensive rebounder we told you about, putting UTEP in front 25-23. Comes back in the ball game. Horton will be the guy going to the line. Ed Horton, and the foul was on Mike Richmond.
Richmond is a must player for them. He's the biggest guy and a real big low post option, so he can't afford to get in foul trouble whatsoever.
First foul on Richmond, and Ed Horton, a strong moose inside, who started at center for the first 24 games of the year. He's just a sophomore out of Springfield, Illinois. In fact, went to the same high school as Kevin Gamble.
Is a wide body, Dick.
A real wide body. Lojas trying to save it, and it's going to be UTEP ball. Kevin Gamble will come back. What a game we have here with UTEP up by one. Inbounding the ball, but let's talk about 2, 3, and 4. Beating the trap, crossing the line, and then attacking the basket.
Well, beating the trap is not so easy, particularly if Lojas surrounds you. And you'll see right here that they do it effectively. It gets inbounded before the trap develops. It's up, and now it crosses the timeline. They get it back into the wingman, and there's only one defender. That's attacking the basket. Jeep Jackson, the wingman on the fast break, can hit it. Any one of these UTEP players can make a strong layup.
UTEP has 14 fast break points to only 2 for Iowa, but Tom mentioned at the outset, they may be running, but this is a defensive game, and the defense will win it. And here's UTEP. 3-on-1 on the steal. Gates is fouled inside. UTEP has no fear of going strong to the hoop every chance they get.
They are leapers, and they are used to taking a number of shots themselves. I tell you, Don Haskins is doing a great job in rotating his people against all this Chinese fire drill that's going on by Tom Davis.
Checking scores and finals from around the NCAA action today. The foul was on Horton, his first foul, and Quentin Gates misses the first free throw.
Gates, very important player, Dick. He is an exceptionally fine ball handler for a big man. They use him in essence at the power forward spot. That's terrific.
And he draws the opposition's top gun on defense as well. And right now, Gates is guarding Roy Marble, who is the top gun for Iowa. 26-24, 8.5 to play, first half.
And UTEP is in a little bit of a zone right now so that they can save a little stamina and also protect against the foul situation and show Iowa a different look.
And it's last touched by Iowa, and great hustle by Wayne Campbell. And it was UTEP that caused another turnover. And they get it inbounds to Quentin Gates. This is a well-coached team. As a matter of fact, both teams are. But keep in mind, UTEP is the underdog against Iowa here. UTEP with a ball and a two-point lead. Blocker slams it through. And a foul. Lojas winds up on the floor.
There Iowa's blocker, a guard, doing that. I'll tell you, there's blocker, a quick forward, a guard, plays three positions. He's free on the baseline. Up he goes, and Lohas, the seven-footer, doesn't go up to block it. He takes the charge instead.
And the foul will be against blocker, his first, but the basket counts. And it's 28-24, and Lohas goes out of the ball game right now. And right now, it's Lorenzi checking back in. So Lorenzi, DJ Armstrong, Kevin Gamble, Roy Marble, and Gary Wright are the five men in there for Iowa.
As much as Tom Davis wants to confuse the other team's offense with his press defense, that's what Haskins is doing right now to Iowa. He's got a zone, a 1-2-2 zone, a 3-2 zone, and you don't expect Haskins to play zone defenses.
Now, Tom Davis said that UTEP used the zone ever so briefly against Arizona and was wary of this. Gamble takes a three-point shot off the mark, and it's last touched by Gamble. It'll be UTEP's ball. Iowa, 28-4 on the year. Their best regular season in history, opened with 18 in a row, top ranked for a long time, but getting all they can handle from the Miners, who turn it over on that inbound pass.
Well, that was a good pass, believe it or not, and Hardaway really thought he was going to catch it and steam up the court instead of catching the ball first.
7:20 remaining, first half of an action-packed half, with UTEP leading the Hawkeyes of Iowa 28-24. The lob pass to Lorenzen doesn't go. Gary Wright goes in and scores for Iowa. Blocker now trapped at midcourt, in trouble. And it's the Iowa ball.
They don't just trap you when you inbound the ball. Sometimes they'll, if they miss you there, they'll cut you off with a trap as soon as you cross the timeline.
And Jeep Jackson comes back in the game.
You got to put pressure on the lone defender. All of a sudden, blocker stops, and there's the trap once again, and blocker can't control it. Those are key turnovers.
Jeep Jackson in the game. He has scored 9 points to lead UTEP. Marble has 8. High score for Iowa. And gambling and almost getting the steal was Jackson. Don Haskin, who has been here 26 years, was called Texas Western at one time and an NCAA title back in 66. Well, going out is Gamble, and Jeff Moe reports back in.
If you can keep track of all these substitutions, Dick, you're a better man than me.
Good one bounce pass into Wright. No basket and a foul. What about that bounce pass that Tom Davis loves to use?
You know, when I was coaching the Boston Celtics, he was at Boston College, and we used to talk about that. And I said, why do you beat the pivot with a bounce pass? And he would say, well, the guys play zones, and they have their hands up, and it's easy to put the ball on the floor. And I always contended that if you got a big man, put it up high so that he can catch the ball and go easily to the hoop. But it's working, it, and he's making it work.
Hardaway commits his second foul, and Wright makes the free throw. Gary Wright really is a center more than a forward. Lohas is more of a forward than a center. It's 28-28, 7 ties. UTEP gets it across with 6.5 to play in the opening game.
But they're not attacking the hoop like they did in the very beginning of this quarter, UTEP.
Fatigue?
No, they should keep attacking. I don't know why they're stopping right now.
Well, maybe a little fatigue. Good pass inside. Wayne Campbell misses, and Lorenzen with the rebound. Pulling up and hitting is Roy Marble. Roy Marble now with 10 points, and he is 5-for-5 from the field.
I'll tell you why they're not attacking. There's two defenders back. And the 3-on-2, they're not quite so sure they're going to attack it with a 3-on-2 situation.
So Iowa has made an adjustment.
Yep.
Alley-oop against two defenders, and Campbell gets the basket. They try to get it to Chris Sandel, but Wayne Campbell, the best offensive rebounder, with a big play. Great save by Chief Jackson. We're tied at 30, and now UTEP can take the lead again.
a very unselfish team, UTEP, boy. They are great team players, all unselfish.
Campbell, you out! And now Iowa, 3-on-2, coming back with DJ Armstrong. And the follow-up by Marble is good, and Iowa regains the lead with 5:08 to go.
They're not turning the ball over like we saw Santa Clara do against Iowa. UTEP right on the money with that press offense.
And you've got to credit Iowa, too. Jeep Jackson with a three-point shot. So Jeep Jackson, 45% from the three-point marker, and it's 33-32. The Miners take the lead again. 4:40 to go. No more than 5 points have separated the two teams so far. Lorenzen gets inside and slices through two defenders. And now it's Iowa regaining the lead by one.
So UTEP slowing it down a little bit.
1-2-2 zone defense by Iowa. That's what they settle into in the half court after you beat the pressure. Chris Sandel misses. Lorenzen is fouled by Wayne Campbell, and that is the bonus for UTEP, and he'll shoot it at the other end. Here's the Bear.
The Bear will never get excited if a man picks up a foul going for the offensive rebound, because that's his kind of basketball. Control the boards and you win.
Protege of the great Henry Iba at Oklahoma State. That's where he learned it first.
Very basic basketball. And I'll tell you, his players are so well coached fundamentally in every aspect of the game.
Lorenzen on the line. Shooting 1-1. Misses in the rebound by Jeep Jackson.
There are no specialists, I don't believe, on a UTEP basketball team. Everybody does everything.
And maybe you can say the same thing for Iowa.
Well, they got this press team.
Richmond with the short jumper. First basket of the game for Mike Richmond, who's averaging 12 and a half. He could be a key before this one's over.
He is got a hit inside, Richmond.
UTEP 35, Iowa 34. Nearly 3.5 to go in the opening stands. Marble shuffles it inside to Gary Wright. Knocked away by Richmond into the hands of Antonio Davis, a freshman from Oakland, California. And Don Haskins has been forced to go to 9 and 10 guys. Normally, he likes to use 7.
That's what Tom Davis forces you to do.
Quinton Gates for 3. UTEP by 4 now.
Gates, a rebounder, an outside shooter.
Gamble to Marble, basket good, and a foul, and Iowa right back at you.
Seems to me we've seen this kind of basketball in other places, Dick.
This is a sensational first half here at Tucson.
You watch this pass into the middle. Look, they surround him, and he finds somehow an opening, and beautiful hoop.
Foul is on Jeep Jackson, and into the ball game is Terry Stallworth, and Roy Marble will go to the line. He is perfect from the field. He has hit all 7 of his shots. And Marble now with 15 points in the ball game, and he has already surpassed his season's average. Well, the Bear still has the lead by 1. Wilkins of coaching and talent. And, of course, he plays down the role of Dr. Tom Davis. A lot of people refer to him as Dr. Tom Davis. His doctorate was in recreational activities of colonial Americans. In other words, Ben Franklin swam.
That's a pretty good thing to be a doctor of, don't you think?
He did the work.
It makes you an automatic expert, doesn't it?
Look at the shooting so far. Iowa. And a lot of them have been the layups, and UTEP, I guess you could say the same thing. Iowa has only 23 shots from the field because of 13 turnovers, so UTEP has had more chances at the hoop. 38-37, UTEP with the ball in the lead, under 3 minutes remaining in a sensationally paced first half, and well played, even though there were turnovers. This is a superb defensive duel here.
And Haskins not afraid to play a freshman. You know, that hasn't seen an awful lot of action. He knows he's got to play him in this ball game. He's a lot of people, and he's doing it.
Talking about Antonio Davis, number 34. But there's Quinton Gates with the layup. They worked the clock and got a great shot.
Hardaway, a beautiful pass. Made them all react to his penetration and found Gates.
40-37 UTEP. Moe and B.J. Armstrong outside. It's Gamble. Lojas inside along with Wright.
They're still in that zone, UTEP. They've gotten away from the man-to-man.
Lojas, who's averaged 11.5, has yet to score in this game. Deep to Wright, and they'll call the foul. Inside was Wayne Campbell and Terry Stallworth, and Stallworth gets hit for his second foul. UTEP is in the penalty. Well, how important is it to be in the West Region and be successful? Well, three of the last four NCAA champions have come out of the Western Regional. And, of course, Iowa, a lot of people think, is headed for a tremendous duel with UNLV. But before that, as we said at the outset, they're going to have to deal with UTEP and Don Haskins as Chris Sandel comes back in. Wright misses the first free throw. Iowa has committed only three fouls in this first half.
That's really surprising when you're dealing with a press team. They don't commit that many fouls. That's how well-schooled they are and not reaching for the ball.
One out of two from Wright. It's 40-38. UTEP in front. Here's the pressure. Tipped by Lojas. There's the seven-footer. Making his presence felt. Armstrong. And the rebound. Taken down by that freshman Antonio Davis.
Boy, did he sky?
Antonio Davis from Oakland, California. And they say he may reach the 7 foot mark before he's through. He's 6'8 now.
He was over 10 feet that time.
There he goes now offensively, and Wright blocks it out of bounds.
Here's what Lojas does to cause you a problem. He's so big that if you try and go over the top of him, he's got his hands up, and there's the steal and the turnover.
Quinton Gates back in, and going out is Antonio Davis. And he looked good in the few moments he was in there.
I tell you, he gave it the 20-minute shuffle, though. You know, like he ran 20 minutes.
Gates. This is the jumper, and Kevin Gamble on the rebound. And now Iowa in a position to tie this game. We've already had 8 ties. There's the time remaining in the lower right-hand of your screen. In the first half, sizzling action. Marvel. He's guarded by Sandel. Armstrong. Now they swing it around. Marvel now guarded by Gates on the other side.
Right, they'll play the zone, but they get right up on the ball.
10 seconds on the shot clock. Gamble. Marvel now fires it up and misses. Great defense by Terry Stallworth that time for UTEP. And Iowa missed the chance to tie it up.
UTEP will work the clock down, take the last shot.
Leading 40-38, an underdog to Iowa. And the makings of an upset here. With the number 2 seed in the West Region, Iowa, getting all they can handle against Don Haskins. Stick'em defense. Gates. Tipped up and in by Wayne Campbell with 3 seconds to go. And the last shot, no good. What a first half.
You're going to see a replay at a tip-in as Campbell just slides in, gets a good inside position, and is right there on Gates' miss to tip it in. I mean, they are not wide, some of these rebounders, but they are slithery like snakes.
And that's the end of the first half with the score. UTEP 42, Iowa 38 in a surprise. CBS Sports coverage of NCAA basketball will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Points has passed the season's average, leading Iowa, and Jeep Jackson has reached his season's average just about with 12 points to lead UTEP. And it's Iowa's possession here. 42-38. They start out with Armstrong, Lojas, Wright, Marble, and Gamble.
And UTEP in their very difficult man-to-man defense, the overplay, the strong deny.
Chris Sandel and Quentin Gates. Mike Richmond, the center. Hardaway and Jackson, the guard. And another turnover against Iowa, and a foul is called.
What makes them such an exceptional defense, UTEP, is that they help each other so effectively. When you get into the middle of the court, you're going to see a lot of orange jerseys around you.
Gamble's first personal foul, and the first foul of this second half. Tim Hardaway, tremendous ball handler. He's out of Chicago, 5'11". Quentin Gates from Los Angeles, number 11. Jeep Jackson is from Carson, California. Sandel from Long Beach, and Mike Richmond from Philadelphia. They kick it around a bit, but UTEP still has it.
Iowa themselves playing a man-to-man defense.
Knocked away by Gamble. Lead is 4, 42-38. Wade was an intermission. Now 11 seconds on the shot clock for the Miners. 5. And Jeep Jackson misses a three-pointer wildly off the glass. Outlet pass to B.J. Armstrong. And a foul, a shooting foul against Tim Hardaway, will send B.J. Armstrong to the line.
UTEP just took too much time off that 45-second clock. Gates had an easy shot inside. Should have taken that one. Instead, Jackson had to take a long bomb under pressure. And Iowa, when they get the rebound, they'll come back up at you with a fast break.
Three fouls on Hardaway. He leaves the game. And Chris Blocker, who scored 4 points, but is a big factor. He is 2 for 3 from the field in the first half, comes in for Hardaway. He's 6'5", so automatically a bigger team in there for Don Haskins.
That's a 6'5 guard. That rebound.
Armstrong misses the free throw. Normally he's a good one at 78%. Now, this is interesting. Iowa this year was 22-0 when they led at halftime. UTEP 21-1 when they led at halftime. So UTEP lost only one game this year when they were in front at intermission. Armstrong makes 1 out of 2, and it's 42-39. Here's the press.
Well, Tom Davis makes adjustments.
And bringing it up is Blocker. Open Sandel for the easy shot.
Blocker, I think, is a great basketball player. Totally under control. Made the entire Iowa defense react. Easy pass for a layup.
UTEP has its biggest lead of the game. Iowa had a 5-point lead early. Marble. Lojas tries to keep it alive, and it's cradled by Quentin Gates. And the biggest lead for either team has been 5 points, and UTEP can forge ahead by 7 here. But they don't. The missed shot by Blocker, and the rebound by Gary Wright. Quickly in the corner is Kevin Gamble, and Gamble scores for Iowa, and it's a 3-point game again.
It's going to go back and forth like this to the very last minute of this game, Dick.
And defense will decide this game. Open his sandal, misses, and Rojas, the leading rebounder for the Hawkeyes, grabbed it. Man-to-man for UTEP. Going strong is Gamble. He's hit 2 in a row inside. Kevin Gamble, strong. And now here's a 2-on-2, Jeep Jackson. Richmond keeps it alive and scores. Big play by Mike Richmond of the Miners.
The center up at the front end of that thing. Good rebound to have if you have a missed layup.
And Marble is fouled inside. They got a good pass inside to him. And the only thing that Richmond could do is foul. And for Mike Richmond, that is his second personal foul. And here is the spark plug off the bench, Jeff Moe, the 6'4 junior from Indianapolis, who is a tremendous three-point shooter and a double-figure scorer coming off the bench for Tom Davis this year. Roy Marble, maybe only a sophomore, but he's considered a veteran by Tom Davis.
He's their best offensive player. He can put it on the floor. If there's a weakness in his game, it's probably the outside shot. But I'm sure before long, he'll have that too.
Iowa, 9 of 14. Makes good on its 10th free throw now. Lorenzen guarding the inbounds passer, and UTEP breaks it easily. 46-45, UTEP in front. And a terrific shot by Richmond. the big man, and we said he might become a key factor before this one was over. Marble trapped in the baseline. Moe gets it back to him. Roy Marble goes up, and they'll call the foul against Sandal of UTEP. We'll say Roy Marble to the line again.
Richard is coming up right through the middle. Beautiful laydown pass. I mean, that's patience and understanding of what can happen if you push the ball up fast.
Second foul on Chris Sandal, and Marble is on the line. Iowa is not an outstanding free throw shooting team. 67% overall coming into this game. But from the field, there's something else. All five starters shot 50% or better. One out of two for Marble. The rebound by Quinton Gates. 48-46. UTEP leading with 16:45 remaining in the second half. Hernell Jeep Jackson with the ball. Finds Richmond.
Iowa back in the zone.
Richmond. And it looks like UTEP is finding a soft spot close to the basket inside.
He's such a quick leaper when he gets that pass. He goes right up over most normal defenders.
50-46. UTEP with the same lead they had at halftime. They go back to Marble. Horton. Horton. Fourth team foul against UTEP.
You watch Richmond now just get that ball as he rolls over the top. Lorenzen lets him in the middle of the zone. Horton doesn't quite get quick enough to him. The left-hand shot up and away before he even know he's got it.
And it'll be Lorenzen inbounding. And coming into the ballgame, Wayne Campbell. Campbell with a very fine first half, had 6 points. And going out is Chris Sandal with 3 personal fouls. Campbell, who had 3 rebounds and 6 points in 13 minutes. Loose ball inside. Gamble gets the basket. 50-48. Campbell trying to get it in and throws it away. And a 5-second violation was called. No basket, but it'll be Iowa ball under the hoop.
And Lorenzen, that look. Lohaus caused that situation and put Campbell under pressure just to inbound it.
And a 3-point shot by DJ Armstrong gives Iowa the lead. 51-50. Jeep Jackson penetrating and going up and giving UTEP the lead by one. And back they come. Armstrong picked up quickly by Chris Blocker. Lorenzen, who's 6'9", playing outside. Just like Rojas does.
They're going to write a pretty effective inside player. So is Horton. And Gamble, he'll do it in there too.
And Wright stepped on the line. Lorenzen goes out. And Rojas is back in the game. And he'll try to harass the inbounds pass. So is Bill Jones, by the way, number 14. Trying to get it in, and he does. Here comes the semi-trap. Now one man on him. UTEP did it well there.
They change it around every once in a while, and they get you thinking you got a beat, and then all of a sudden they make it look like something different, which they did right there. Ready to trap you at half court. Haskins says, I'm going to call a timeout to make an adjustment.
He's a throwback as a coach who's just a coach, not an entrepreneur. That's Don Haskins.
To get the ball inbounded, huh? There's a 7-footer, Lohaus, and a fake to the middle. They want you to inbound the ball into the corner, but Haskins will have none of that. He'll get it to you right in the middle. Now, as soon as the ball is inbounded, they get it up quickly. There's a little confusion as Tom Davis had adjusted that defense, but now they bring it up quickly, get it over, and still attack the basket.
Quinton Gates will inbound for UTEP, leading 52-51. The winner will play Oklahoma on Friday night in Seattle in the Western Regional Semifinals. UNLV in Wyoming will be the other game. Out west.
1-2 zone defense now by Iowa, Dick.
And that's their patented half-court defense. Quinton Gates misses a 3-point attempt and the rebound by Bill Jones. He's out of Detroit and a steal. Jeep Jackson going the distance. play by Jackson, and UTEP is up by three.
Are they pesky little guards?
Yes.
Hardaway and Jeep Jackson. I wouldn't want to dribble against them.
Jackson has five steals and 16 points in the game, and the leading score for UTEP. Mike Richmond knocks it away into the hands of Hardaway. Hardaway working into the corner. Jackson passes up the shot, and UTEP will work for it.
And he passed up, making a pass, too, which was pretty smart. He would have had to throw it through the entire Iowa defense.
3-point lead, and UTEP trying to match their biggest bulge of the game. If they can score. Richmond lost the ball. He was in good position. He just lost it.
They had overloaded the zone, put an extra man on that baseline. He was wide open. Couldn't handle the ball.
Lojas, the seven-footer outside. Gamble and Jones now move outside. And UTEP playing a zone defense now.
That's what was so successful.
Inside to right.
Oh!
Richmond snares the rebound.
Ho-ho!
And now Hardaway. He is a very smart young man, a sophomore from Chicago. And they have a wet spot that they want to towel up, but Tim Hardaway has made great strides as a point guard. His free throw shooting improved, and he is easily the best ball handler on this team. Well, Thursday night, we have a primetime game. It'll be Notre Dame and North Carolina for most of you. Some of you will see Georgetown against Kansas at 9 o'clock Eastern, 6 Pacific. And in 11:30, you will see another broadcast. Florida against Syracuse. That'll be Thursday night. Richmond, baseline shot. And UTEP is leading by five, which matches their biggest lead.
He's getting in the slot on the bottom of the Iowa defense.
Richmond has hit his last five shots and has 10 points. Eight of them here in the second half. 13 minutes, 10 seconds, the time. Campbell slices in. No foul. And the rebound by Wayne Campbell. 2-on-1. Jackson. Offensive foul against Jeep Jackson. That'll be his second.
Excellent defense by Armstrong. He had to defend against two nifty ball-handling guards, and he made Jeep Jackson commit, cut off the pass to Hardaway. You watch this, how great it is. Here it is. A drive, and Gamble, all of a sudden, they're off and running. And Richmond goes down hard underneath. They need him, no question about that.
Team fouls. UTEP already has committed five to only one for Iowa. And Iowa did not commit many fouls in the first half, and that's why UTEP has gone to the free throw line only three times in this game. Not because they're not calling it. That's because Iowa stayed out of foul trouble pretty well. Marble out to Armstrong for three, and B.J. Armstrong brings Iowa to within 2 points.
Big hoop.
Armstrong has 13 now. He has passed his season's average of 12. 12 and a half to go in the second half. Wayne Campbell doesn't get the bounce, and Lojas with the rebound.
He intimidated Campbell, Lojas did.
Lojas for three. And Brad Lojas hit on 22 three-point shots during this season.
A very unusual seven-footer.
57-56, and Iowa regains the lead with 12 minutes to go. Crowd standing now. They're into this. Richmond foul inside against the Hawkeyes. And coming into the ball game is Chris Sandel, who is playing with three personal fouls. And this will be the second team foul against Iowa. And it goes against Kevin Gamble, his second, as Jeff Moe checks back in and Gamble sits down.
Well, the challenge to Don Haskins was to rotate his people in some similar fashion as to Tom Davis, so he would have fresh troops coming down the last part of the second half. And he certainly rotated his people quite nicely.
Mike Richmond, junior college transfer who was redshirted. He had 18 points and 11 rebounds in the first round.
I tell you, he is a moose in there. He spreads out, and he takes it strong to the hoop, and he's got a nice fall-away jump shot, or straight-up jump shot, I should say, in the low post.
And a good touch on the free throw. So Iowa's lead cut to one. Richmond out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
3-2 zone by UTEP.
No team has had a bigger lead than 5 points. Marble fights for the rebound. Lojas goes after it and is fouled, and that should go against Iowa as Richmond went up vertically. You see some of the scores. Florida beating Purdue, and they'll face Syracuse in our late night broadcast Thursday night in the regional semifinals. Foul was on Jeff Moe. Check that. Roy Marble, his first.
I got to tell you, I am totally appreciative of your efforts on every substitution. This was not an easy game in regards to substitutions. Keep track of all of that.
It's better when five play all 40 minutes.
That's it, huh?
Well, I think your analysis is appreciated also, because it's a quick-paced game and a lot of nuances in the defensive end of it. Lockner with a jumper. Chris Lockner. Boy, he is a solid, sound, fundamental player.
He is going to be a big one. He's only been at UTEP 1 year. A junior college transfer. He's got 1 year to go.
Lojas hits another three-pointer. That's two this half, and it's 60-60. And our ninth tie of the game. UTEP breaks the press, and they're very patient. Other than Jeep Jackson, I haven't seen a UTEP player force a shot in this game.
Not really.
Very patient, poised team. Blocker for three. Chris Blocker now with nine in the game.
He is a player. Some six man, Haskins has it. Chris Blocker.
And we know about Jeff Mose handling the ball for Iowa. Maybe the best six man in the country. At least the one that got the publicity. To the baseline, Roy Marble. And here's Hardaway. 2-on-1 fast break. And it's Blocker who goes up. Jeff Moore with breaking up that 2-on-1.
Beautiful hustle play. Got him from behind when he put the ball behind his head.
Boy, Iowa's defense is great when they're down 2-on-1 or 3-on-1 sometime. Now they're going to have another chance to show how great they are. But Hardaway gets the basket.
Now Hardaway was under control. Jeep Jackson the last time against Armstrong went up too fast, too strong. It was a little bit out of control. Armstrong played him for that.
UTEP again with a five-point lead and a timeout called by Iowa. But there are two distinguished assistant coaches on the UTEP side. Norm Ellenberger is a volunteer coach. He's the former head coach at New Mexico who left after recruiting and academic scandals at Albuquerque. But Don Haskins values his opinions greatly. Good man to have around. And what about the other guys?
Well, of course, Tiny Archibald, a great middleman and offensive guard, one of the all-time greats of the NBA. I'm sure that he can teach these pesky little guards at UTEP a lot of little things that perhaps they never knew existed. And it looks to me like he's caught their ear. They claim that they've been very helpful, both coaches, to the young players.
65-60 with 9:23 remaining. UTEP has its biggest lead now. Iowa early in the game had a 5-point lead. Lojas getting position, blocked by Richmond out of bounds. Great play by Richmond, who has played a sensational game.
Here comes that bounce pass. Lojas has to come up and then go up and waits too long and allows an extra defender to get in there.
Steal on the inbound pass by Quinton Gates. So UTEP causing Iowa problems on the inbound. And now the Miners looking to establish their biggest lead of the game with 9 minutes to go. UTEP led by four at the half. Iowa the favorite and the second seed in the West region behind UNLV. Out out of the Big Ten in a great year with only four losses. And no losses outside their conference.
Pretty good patience right here by UTEP.
Hardaway. There is the shot clock down to six on your left. Sandel hits the shot with 5 seconds, and now the biggest lead either team has had in the game, UTEP by seven. Marble, though, comes back in a hurry, and Marble with 20 points. 67-62. They beat it again, this time with Chris Locker. Swift move. And the foul is against Horton of Iowa. Horton of Iowa, that'll be the 14th foul against the Hawkeyes.
We're going to see some banging going on underneath. Here comes Blocker, a nice spin move back inside, gets the shot away on the miss. As Horton says, go down, you dog, go down. It's my ball. But the foul is on Horton.
Wayne Campbell out of New Orleans. Iowa with a big advantage on the free throw line. UTEP has only gone to the line five times. And of course, Iowa not fouling much and not sending UTEP into the bonus at all. Kick ball and a new clock. Well, it stays at 45, of course, and Quinton Gates against Lorenzen's outstretched arms. Here's the trap in the corner. UTEP got away with it that time. But now Iowa's really tightened the knots defensively here.
And Reeves in the back court a little bit. New fresh feet and hands.
And the basket by Gates with 10 now. 69-62. Michael Reeves, a 6'3 junior from Milledgeville, Georgia. And many people say the best defensive point guard on the team. Horton trying to go to Marble on the baseline. And the foul is against Quinton Gates of UTEP. There's six team fouls. Six team fouls against the Miners.
Here's the strong drive by Reeves, by Gates. Strong up to the hoop. And when you allow him to get on that baseline, he's clever enough to, with that dribbling ability, to score.
Armstrong for three. And B.J. Armstrong now hits his third three-pointer of the game. And UTEP's lead cut to four, 69-65. Locker. Great shot by Wayne Campbell. And all UTEP did is beat the press and make Iowa pay.
Attack the basket. Attack the basket. Once you get past the Campbell part, it's your advantage.
UTEP all over Iowa, winding down to 7 minutes to go in this game. 71-65. The Miners lead, and they have led, except for a couple of moments throughout leading the first half, driving in and getting the basket. For Iowa is Horton. Coming right back, Chief Jackson. Crashing the boards is UTEP, and on the floor is Chris Blocker, and a foul against the Hawkeyes, and that will send UTEP to the free throw line. Don Lorenzen, 15th foul.
Watch him inbound Campbell right now. Lorenzen very active, moving from side. You're allowed to do that. That puts a little heat on the defense, creates an opening for them to inbound the ball.
Richmond comes in, and Sandel goes out. Don Haskins is matching Tom Davis sub for sub in this game.
You know, Tom Davis has a theory on substitutions. He wants you to play full out. If you raise your hand and tell him you're tired and you go sit on the bench, you can come back in when you're not tired, when you're ready to go. But if you don't tell him you're tired and he takes you out, then it's his discretion when he puts you back in.
What do you think of that system?
I think it's pretty good.
Locker misses both free throws. The UTEP hasn't had much of a chance at the line and not getting any opportunity. When they get the opportunity, they're not doing it. And traveling is called against Kevin Gamble, and that is the 19th turnover by Iowa as Tim Hardaway comes back in the game, and going out is Chris Blocker. So they got the good ball handler now, UTEP. Not that the others don't do it well. And it's 71-67, UTEP ball.
A 1-2-1-1 zone press.
Is that like UCLA's? Traveling called.
A man cannot, on an out-of-bounds play, move along the baseline. He can only do do that after a score. We saw him move along the baseline before. This time, when the ball went out of bounds, he's only allowed one step. And that's why he was called for traveling.
Lorenzen inbounds it to Marvel, who gets the basket. Tough inside basket by Roy Marvel, who has 22 points. Armstrong 16 and Gamble 10 for Iowa. UTEP has Jackson with 16 and Richmond with 12 and Gates 10. And a timeout called by UTEP. They had a 7-point lead at one point, but Don Haskins Miners have seen their lead cut to two. The round of 16. Oklahoma beat Pittsburgh by 3 points in the first encounter, and the winner of this game will face Oklahoma in Seattle in the West Regional Semifinals on Friday. The other half of the bracket played in Salt Lake saw top-seeded UNLV advance along with Wyoming over UCLA. So there are 15 teams out of 16 all set for the regional semifinals, and this is the last piece in the puzzle. Lohaus back in the ball game for Iowa, and it'll be Quinton Gates again on the inbounds pass, looking right into the face of Lohaus. Dick Stockton and Tom Heinsohn in a thrilling game here. Richmond gets by his defender. Campbell battling, but the rebound brought down by Ed Horton. Iowa looking to tie the game. Horton inside, and traveling called against Iowa. Turns it over, so the Hawkeyes miss a chance to tie the game.
And again, the old challenge. Get the ball inbound.
They've done a good job of that today. A good job.
And Iowa not really playing hard on those traps in the corner because they know they're not going to work. They're getting a little demoralized, both the coaching staff and the players. The traps aren't working.
Whoever thought that Iowa would commit a lot more turnovers than UTEP in this game? Looking at Iowa's formidable full-court pressure. There's the time remaining in the second half. UTEP leading 71-69. They led by four at the half. It's been close, 7 points, the biggest margin. That by UTEP with 8 minutes left. Richmond inside against Horton, short on it. Loose ball, and it's still UTEP. And you got to credit UTEP's ability to fight for that rebound and loose ball.
They are hanging tough, close to the basket. That's what Don Haskins said. This team has got lots of moxie.
Chris Sandel checks back in for the Miners. And going out is Quinton Gates for the moment. No, he's in there. Keith Jackson just misses a three-pointer and Marble the rebound. Iowa trying to tie it up again. Iowa, very talented team. Lohaus trying to put Iowa in front with that shot. And he'll call the foul on Sandel, I believe, inside. And that will be Sandel's fourth personal foul. Tommy, the rebounding story of this game. You know, Sooner, you got to have the class. Iowa led the nation coming in with the best rebounding margin. That's 12 rebounds better than their opponents. But today, their rebounding edge is only 4.
Well, when you do all that upbeat type of thing, running and what have you, it makes rebounding easy because nobody can block you out. But UTEP has, like I said at the top of the show, a very fundamentally sound team. They block you out very effectively, so you don't get that natural advantage off this quick-paced game.
Of course, Iowa in the bonus right now. They still have one foul to give before UTEP will be in the 1-1. And Marvel, who has been the leading scorer in the game, he has been the heart and soul of Iowa's offense with 23 points, is 5-for-6 from the stripe. Now 6-for-7 in a tie at 71. We have had 10 ties in this game. Hardaway. High off the glass. Foul is called inside, and it appears to be against the Hawkeyes. And if it's on Horton, it will be his third personal foul, and that would be the sixth foul against Iowa. So one more, and it'll be the 1-1. They call it on Kevin Gamble, and that's 3 on Gamble. Tom Davis, who started his coaching career at Lafayette, then the Boston College, where he just missed making the Final Four. Looking to get into the regional semifinals here. Turnaround by Wayne Campbell breaks the tie again for UTEP.
Get it inside if you can at key points of the ball game. That's where you're either going to get the easy shot or the foul.
Campbell off the bench has 10 points, and now you see why UTEP came in with six players in double figures on the season. Zone defense by UTEP. They've changed up and used the zone perhaps a lot more than Don Haskins is used to using.
And I'm sure they prepared mostly for man-to-man.
Gamble, way in and is fouled. Good move by Gamble, good first step.
With a 3-2 zone, if you can get by into the gut of that thing, you can usually take it all away. That's what's happening. Gamble has alertly been driving the lane.
And Chris Sandel is fouled out of the ball game. The leading scorer for UTEP on the year at 13 points has fouled out. He fouled out after scoring only 9 points in the first round. And he scores 8 today, and he's replaced by Mike Richmond in the lineup. So Chris Sandel, the junior, is out of there. And here is Gamble shooting 2. Into the NCAA's 8 of the last 9 years. UTEP 4 in a row. They're used to tournament play. And UTEP doing a tremendous job against an outstanding Iowa team.
Come down to the wire, Dick.
73 all, and a 3-point shot missed by Quentin Gates.
Horton is getting those crucial rebounds that Tom Davis told us about yesterday.
Rojas inside is fouled and will go to the line. Working the ball inside, and Brad Lohaus, who, according to Tom Davis, says he has a Dave Cowens mentality about basketball. He says, let's go play.
Plays hard. Doesn't have red hair, though, like Cowens did. It's sandy blonde.
Foul is on Quentin Gates, his third. And here's Lohaus. 69% from the line on the year.
He's an unusual player in that 7 feet and a good outside shooting ability. And in that prior game, I saw him play a lot in the low post, and he scored pretty well down there.
Chris Blocker coming in for Quentin Gates now for UTEP. Gates goes out, having scored 10. But Lohaus is the only player left from the Lute Olson era, who preceded George Raveling, the last Iowa coach before Tom Davis. Really a forgotten man who found a second life here. Takes 1 out of 2. And it's 74-73 Iowa. Jeep Jackson. Blocker. 3:50 to go. Iowa zone. 1-2-2. Blocker out on the point. Works his way in. Richmond fighting for the rebound, and a foul will be called against Iowa. And that may be on Ed Horton. And it'll be the 1-1. It's the bonus time. Both teams in the bonus. And for Horton, his third foul.
You know, Blocker went down the lane on the drive. He'd be a key player coming down the stretch because he's big, and he can take it to the hoop, and he's a good foul shooter. And they have not gotten to the line an awful lot, like you said, Dick. But right now, Richmond, 7 times, 3 for 7. And they've been trying a lot of inside plays, too.
I'll get you one of those after the game, Tommy, and put it on your face.
Okay. I'll get you one of those.
74-73 Iowa, UTEP looking for the lead. And Richmond, who's 63% shooter from the line, is 3 for 3 today. As you look at the foul story, Sandel has already fouled out, and the rest who have 3. 1 out of 2 for Richmond. And the game is tied at 74. Biggest lead was 7, that by UTEP with 8 minutes to go, and Iowa's come back.
UTEP back in, a man-to-man.
Marble, the tough man, goes by blocker, blocked, and a foul call. Wayne Campbell is called for the foul, and a tremendous move by Roy Marble as he went around by Chris Blocker with ease.
What a fake he lays on him. Now you see, Blocker has to fight through a pick, and he's a little late. That's what created that lifting action, and there's Campbell swatting it away, but picking up the foul.
Haskins and Davis fighting it out with 3:11 to go. We're all tied. Before we know who will be in the final round of 16, UTEP and Iowa tied at 74, and UTEP has only one timeout remaining with 3:11 to play. The foul story, and no one has four. Chris Sandel already is fouled out for UTEP, and they come out with Richmond, Blocker, Jackson, Hardaway. And the fifth man is Wayne Campbell, who committed the foul, and Roy Marble will go on the line to try to give Iowa the lead again. Marble today is 6-for-7 from the free throw line and is the game's high scorer with 24.
As he got some nice moves, that last up fake move and the ability to step fast the way he did. I mean, that's dynamite stuff you're talking about.
Normally, the stars in Tom Davis's system are the guards, like at Boston College, John Bagley and Michael Adams. Mostly Bagley, but Marble is doing a pretty good job of it. So Iowa leads by two, 76-74, winding down to 3 minutes to go.
They're in a zone, Iowa.
Blocker, short, Lojas, the rebound. Iowa with the ball and the lead. UTEP led by four at the half and stretched it to seven before the Hawkeyes came back.
Now they're being pretty patient right now, Iowa. Trying to get the ball and a good shot.
Looping pass from Horton to Gamble and the layup by Gamble. 4-point lead for Iowa.
What a pass that was.
Blocker, double team. Richmond at the baseline. Lays it up and in and a foul. UTEP coming right back, and it's 78-76.
We're going to see the last pass. The whole left side of the court is cleared out, so there's no help if they can get the ball over the top, which they do beautifully, and then it's an easy two.
Meanwhile, Ed Horton has committed his fourth personal foul. Using both of their big men, Lojas and Horton, who stays in the game. It's 78-77 Iowa.
We could be playing this game through June, Nick.
UTEP goes back to the zone, Tommy. Keep in mind, the Miners have only one timeout left. Marble in the baseline. And Iowa calls timeout. Hawkeyes have two left. And Tom Davis will discuss it with the Hawkeyes up by one. We'll head a regional semifinal. Most of you will see Notre Dame against North Carolina from East Rutherford. Some of you will see Georgetown against Kansas. John Thompson and Larry Brown, that's 6 o'clock Pacific time. And then our late night game, which will be on tape delay, Eastern and Pacific, will be the Eastern regional semifinal between Florida and Syracuse from East Rutherford, New Jersey. That's the action coming away Thursday. Tommy Davis called a timeout now. Iowa has the ball and 20 seconds on the shot clock in a one-point lead.
Why not get it to the guy who can put some shake and bake moves on you? And who is that? Mr. Marble right there.
26 for Marble. Short on the jumper, but a big offensive rebound by Ed Horton, who's playing with four personal fouls, and Iowa has a new clock with a minute and a half to play.
You cannot allow a ball club to take a shot and on the miss get the rebound back.
UTEP has done a pretty good job of that this year, this game. Not giving up too many second shots. Inside Horton. puts Iowa up by three.
Big move, and blocker is down.
Slow getting up, Chris Blocker. Shaken up for the moment.
We're going to see the great pass coming inside to Horton. He swings around, and then the shot is scored, and Blocker is hit by his own man. I believe it was Campbell.
Iowa did not pressure the inbound passer that time, and Blocker brings it across. Has to watch out from the defense behind. 1 minute to go, and 37 on the shot clock. Iowa in the zone.
They don't have to go for three right now.
Hardaway short on the looping shot. Gamble for Iowa. A three-point lead for the Hawkeyes, and now UTEP is under the gun. Armstrong, a good free throw shooter, but timeout is called for Iowa. 20 seconds, 32 seconds remaining in the game. And 30 seconds on the shot clock. Each team with one timeout remaining. And they're not really giving UTEP much of a cushion to get anything going if they run the clock out. Center, the scene of a tremendous second round battle between upset minded UTEP and Iowa, the number two seed in the West region. A game in which 7 points has been the biggest margin, and UTEP with a 4-point lead at the half at a 69-62 lead with 8 minutes to go, but Iowa crept back, and now the Hawkeyes seemingly in command with the ball and 32 seconds left in a 3-point lead.
And they got to try for steal, and UTEP is perfectly capable of making steals. They're a crafty defensive ball club, but it's inbounded pretty easily.
And the foul on Blocker, but he fouled the wrong guy. If there's such a thing under this kind of pressure, Roy Marvel will go to the line, and he's been nearly perfect from the free throw line all night. 31 seconds to go, and a chance to put Iowa up by five. And that would make it real tough for UTEP.
Yeah, Iowa has played a super basketball game in that they did not succumb to the fact that UTEP was able to beat that defense that they count so much on.
They did beat it, but Iowa is a real strong club, and they didn't fold. Now Marvel, 9 for 10 from the line, will try to open it to 5. UTEP has one timeout remaining. In the game is Quentin Gates. UTEP, now you can say, well, you got to go for the three now, but they still need to. They're going to send their guys back to defend against that.
Take the press off. That's the first time he's done it all night, and he, well, he should right now. He doesn't want them to foul.
You go for two or three now. Blocker answers the question. This is a three, and the rebound by Kevin Gamble. And Blocker commits the foul, and Iowa can win it on the line here. Going sliding is Kevin Gamble. What an effort.
Going to see him go out and try and pick off the ball, and there's Gamble, safe at third. And if he gets up, he'll probably be able to go home.
Gamble will go to the line, where he is a 71% free throw shooter and 2 for 2 on the game. And UTEP has that look of, boy, we fought real hard, but fell short. That's the look they have now.
Well, they can't be too
really distraught. This is the 1-1, no. And it's not over. Hardaway, Jeep Jackson for three. Fight for the loose ball. And Booker Turner, I believe, is called a foul. It'll be a foul against Iowa, I believe. And Ed Horton, who is now fouled out of the game.
Horton came up with some very big rebounds, Dick. Tom Davis said we've got to have, he's our crucial rebounder, and he's certainly delivered those rebounds tonight.
3 points and six big rebounds for Ed Horton. He's replaced by Gary Wright. 9 seconds remaining, and Iowa in front by five, which matches their biggest lead of the ball game. And Mike Richmond is on the line, 1-1. UTEP has one timeout remaining. And that's what Don Haskins has just checked over at the scorer's table. 42-38, UTEP at half. And Richmond now with 18 points, 16 in the second half. And the last timeout has been called by Wily Don Haskins. The winner of this game. And it'll be Iowa or UTEP playing Oklahoma. Seattle in the Western Regional Semifinal. All of the other berths have been filled going into the regional semifinals. UTEP has exhausted its last timeout with 9 seconds to go. 82-79 is the score. And Don Haskins has done a marvelous job. But let's credit Iowa and Tom Davis, because they only lost 4 games and showed why they were ranked number one most of the year.
Both teams really fundamentally sound basketball team. I was so impressed with both teams tonight.
Lojas will inbound with 9 seconds to go, and a lead pass to Gary Wright, and he seals the game, and a foul as well. And that's all she wrote. Dr. Jamalot, they call Gary Wright, and he got a chance to show why. 79, and Iowa will advance to the Western Regional Semifinals and play Oklahoma on Friday night. But a great performance, gutty performance by UTEP. They'll be disappointed, Tommy, but they got a lot to be proud of.
I'm going to send them a red tie, I'll tell you that. I think maybe I'll have Rodney Dangerfield send them a red tie, because they need to get something out of this, as UTEP ball club. A lot of respect they got from me.
Final second. Hits the three at the buzzer, and Tom Davis has won it. Iowa wins it 84-83.
They had a denied inbound ball, and Iowa up to the challenge, just had their man take off up the court, and he was wide open. And look at Tom Davis.
UTEP with a tremendous obstacle to Iowa, and Tom Davis knew it. He had to sweat it out all the way, and his reaction. He's gone to Seattle in his first year at Iowa, and Don Haskins, who has won an NCAA championship, loses as Iowa held UTEP to only 2 baskets in the last 441. 84-82, Iowa wins it. So long from Tucson.
All right, Dick Stockton, so Iowa escapes the upset there, and the Chevy MVPs for the game, Jeep Jackson for UTEP, and Roy Marble for Iowa. How did the Hawkeyes do that, James Brown?
Individually, I think the players that stepped up to the challenge for Iowa were Roy Marble and Kevin Gamble. Just played instinctive basketball when they needed it most. But a lot of credit has to be given to Ed Horton, who was an absolute bull on the boards, intimidating UTEP down the stretch when Iowa needed it.